Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for being here today. My name is Sylvia Mange Alene, and I am the co-founder and president of Kulea Culture Society. I want to thank you all for attending this event. Before we go any further, I would like to acknowledge the land from which I'm speaking to you this afternoon. I want to acknowledge the land that I am a settler in, the land of the Lekwungen people, now known as the Songhees and Esquimalt Nations, who are part of the Coast Salish territory. I am very grateful for their generosity to allow me to live, work, and raise my son in their lands. The mission of Kulea Culture Society is to promote equity, diversity, and inclusion in our communities through programs, cross-cultural exchange, and learning activities events such as the one we are going to have this afternoon. At Kulea Culture, we believe that knowing about each other's culture and ways of living through education and information is critical if we want to live in a society that is more understanding, more inclusive, and more compassionate. Education is also critical in reducing discrimination, prejudice, and racism, because we grow our capacity for understanding and for compassion. So today, we are here to learn about and with members of the 2SLGBTQ community. This community is an integral part of our society that enriches and strengthens our lives, our prospects, and our futures. In this regard, we are very lucky to have with us the representative of two SLGBTQ+ organizations, the Welcome Friends Association, which is located in Ontario, and the Community Society, which is located in Vancouver. 3 months ago, when I reached out to them to participate in this event with Kulea Culture, they did not hesitate. They understood without any resentment that when someone knocks at your door asking for solidarity, understanding, and inclusivity, you can't say no to them. I thank you for your generosity and insights in putting this event together. During this event, the Welcome Friend Association and the Community Society are going to guide us through the issues and challenges the as LGBTQ plus community face in their daily lives, so that we become more aware and better at offering and activating our support. And also to reach out to them to learn from their knowledge, experiences, and lessons learned. We are all together on this, as we all want to overcome social injustice. We want a better community. We want a better Victoria, a better Canada, and the world, wherever we and our allies find ourselves. I know that this event will help us grow and be better. Now I will pass it on to Steph, who is the ED of Welcome Friend Association. So please, Steph, take it away.
Hi, Celia, and thank you so much for that wonderful land acknowledgement and wonderful warm welcome. I am coming to all of you right now through this live stream from the area known as Tukurano, which has been caretaken by the Anishinaabeg Nation, the Haudenosaunee Confederacy, and the Huron-Wendat. It is now home to many First Nation, Inuit, and Métis communities, and the current treaty holders are the Mississauga of Port Credit First Nation. My name is Stephanie Voyer. I use she, her pronouns, and on behalf of Welcome Friend Association, my team and I are thrilled to be part of this event. Welcome Friend Association is a not-for-profit organization that works to educate and promote awareness regarding gender and sexuality, identities, expression, and diversity. We also provide outreach support and connection opportunities for individuals who identify as 2SLGBTQ allies and their families. Some Welcome Friend Association programs include Rainbow Camp, an overnight summer camp for queer and gender diverse youth, allies, and children in LGBT families, and Rainbow Online Connection, which is our virtual COVID Rainbow Camp counterpart, and also the mode for year-round activities and programs, just like the event that you are watching and participating in right now. The theme of this event is activism through allyship, and we'll go for about an hour and a half. We are both Welcome Friend Association and Kulea Culture Society are both not-for-profit organizations, and we work to promote social justice and growth in community. If you are interested in donating at any time during today's event, the proceeds will be split between the organizations, and you can find the link below. We will give you more details on this throughout the stream and at the end, of course. And we also, I would like to quickly introduce our two behind the scenes tech masters, tech wizards extraordinaire, and our, YouTube moderators, Mallory and Paul. I don't know if you guys want to turn your cameras on, give a little wave. There's Paul, there's Mallory. Thank you so much to our behind the scenes folks in stage, right? We always thank our tech people. Thank you so much for making today happen. And there will be a portion of the discussion where you can write the questions to our panelists later, and you will just write that into the chat box, and Mallory and Paul will be the ones who are taking your questions and handing them over to us so we can have your questions answered to our panelists. They'll also be ensuring that the conversation stays respectful in the chat and making sure that everybody is allies among each other. The goal of today's event is to provide basic entry-level information on the practical insight and knowledge on how to be an ally to 2SLGBTQ or two-spirit, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, and queer community, and also the BIPOC community, which stands for Black, Indigenous, and People of Color. We believe that the more information we share, the better allies we can be for each other. With that, I am going to hand it back over to Sylvia, who has a few messages that she'd like to say before we get into our performances and the panel.
Hello. Thank you. Thank you, Steph. We were very kind. Our mayor, the mayor Victoria, was very kind to donate her time. And so we're going to watch a video of her saying a few words, especially for this event. So please put the video ahead.
I of a sound issue.
Unfortunately, it seems like we are having some issues, some technical issues with the sound, and we will not be able to hear the message from our mayor, the mayor Victoria Lisa Helps. But to recap, she was just congratulating us for this event, and she just wanted to wish us the best on this event, and that it was a great initiative. So she was very thankful and grateful. Thank you.
What we can also do is we'll take that video and put it on our YouTube. And so once this is live in the future, if you want to watch the link to that, we'll just put a link to that video in the description box. So we can put it as a separate video on our YouTube, just so that nobody misses it, because we really appreciate her doing that for us. All right. Thanks, Sylvia.
So now we are going to move forward, and we are going to have a lot of fun, because we have great performances, and also we have great panelists that are going to be educating us today. And to no further ado, I'm going to introduce you our first performer. Her name is beautiful name. So Asia is a she/her pronoun, and she's an upcoming singer-songwriter from Vancouver, Canada. Asia was born in Philadelphia, raised in Vancouver with a Nigerian background. By the age of 10, Asia discovered her love for music, songwriting, and performing. Her genres include R&B, rap, soul, with touches of jazz, and poetic rap. Wow. Her passion for music only continues to grow, and hopes to share her sound with the world. So Asia, take it along, and let's listen.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much. I'm so happy to be here. Yes, I do go by Asia, and I am a singer-songwriter and poet here in Vancouver, Canada. And I'm so excited to share with you one of the first poems that I'll ever be performing in front of a live audience. So, yeah. All right. All my life, I knew I was different, but I didn't know where, how, or why. As if my own eyes couldn't read between the lines. So I asked myself, who am I? Well, I go by she, her, and I'm black, and it doesn't matter what flavor, color, or pronoun you hold, because if I like your soul, then I like you as a whole. And I think that's all that should matter. And if you didn't think it could get any better, I was adopted by two moms who raised me together, and I think I turned out okay. Or at least that's what my parents say. I didn't come out till I was 19 years old. I didn't tell my gay parents that I was gay till I was finally reaching legal age, but I guess somewhere deep down I was still afraid. Afraid of what they would say, or the fear of praise, or maybe from the world not accepting me. But there doesn't need to be a divide from people who just want to be who they are inside. So I hope that somehow, someday, everyone will be able to say happy pride. So. That is one I wrote specifically for this event. It's one of my favorites so far. And yeah, so happy to be here. And I will pass it back to you guys.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. That was a lovely poem. And we really look forward to hearing a performance from you in a few minutes. So now we are going to go ahead and introduce our panelists. And this is very exciting. So this is the big part of what our event is today. So I invite our panelists to go ahead and turn your cameras on so I can read your bios and introduce you to the good people watching us today. All right. So do we have all your cameras on? Oh my gosh, you guys are gorgeous, wonderful. Okay, so here among our two organizations putting this event on today, we believe that storytelling is how we not only share experiences and knowledge, but it is how we learn, grow, understanding, and actively participate in making the world a more inclusive and equitable space for all identities to thrive. We invite you to think about questions for our panelists and write them in the chat as you are thinking of them, because as I said previously, we have the wonderful Mallory and Paul who are going to be taking those questions, and then we have a Q&A portion later. So once we open up to Q&A, we want to converse over all of your questions, because I'm sure you've got really good ones. So quickly, I'm going to introduce our panelists. And so what this is going to look like after they give a little wave to introduce themselves, we are going to then go into, they each have a bigger question that they're going to speak on from about between like 5 to 7 to 10 minutes, not in between those, one of those 3 minutes. That's a kid, that's a joke. And then they are going to comment on each other's questions, ask each other a little bit. So we get to watch them kind of converse, similar to like The View or something, only activist. And we are going to then have a performance, and then we are going to come back to our Q&A, which is your questions. So at any time during this, put your questions in the chat and we will get to them. All right, right on. So first I'm going to introduce Tristan Desaunier, uses he, him pronouns. Tristan, give a wave so they know which one you are. There he is. He is a transgender writer and primary care paramedic in Ontario. He has his BA honors in drama, English, and creative writing from the University of Windsor and is passionate about the crossroads between medicine and the arts. In the fall, he will be starting his Master's of Science and Technology Studies at York University. All right. That's very exciting. And next we have on our panel, Vincent Bolt. Give a wave, my friend. He uses he, him pronouns, and he works at the with me at Rainbow Online Connection. He is a social worker psychotherapist in private practice. He is completing his Master of Social Work through the University of Victoria. He has been involved in 2S LGBTQ plus activism since 2006. He lives in Sudbury with his temperamental rabbit named Frith. All right. And last but certainly not least, we have Rana. Give away, Rana. Awesome. Rana is the specialist, education and training at Community since 2018. Over more than 14 years, she has worked on creating and holding safe spaces for conscientious conservations and conflict resolution. She is a social activist for diversity and inclusion and human rights. She has built a strong career in peace building, conflict resolution, and restorative justice and community engagement. Through these programs, she has helped bridge the gap between people from different political affiliations, ethnicities, beliefs, and backgrounds, and has increased their ability to lead and change the way they want to they see their societies, circles, and workplaces. So thanks so much, Rana, for being here. Thank you all of our panelists. They're all such amazing people. I'm really excited to have them here today, selfishly, because I think they're wonderful people and excellent friends, but also I'm really excited to share what's in their brilliant minds with the world, because we need more inclusivity now more than ever, as we are rebuilding a world that is going to be different, right, after COVID. So how can we do that in a way that's inclusive? We're going to start off our juicy conversation between them with, we'll start off with you, Vincent. So first, as I said prior, I'm going to remind everybody in case you missed it, or if you're joining now, this is welcome to our panel. We are going to start off by asking like the main bigger question to get our panelists warmed up and ready for your quick fire Q&A. So Vincent, you're going to talk for about 5 to 10 minutes on your question, and then the other two panelists will have a chance to respond. We'll go around like that. Then we're going to have a performance. Then we'll get to your Q&A. So feel free to ask your questions at any time, but we will not get to them until the Q&A portion. Thank you so much. All right, Vincent. So to get you warmed up and started and ready for the Q&A, I'd like to have you start talking about why is it important to use a person's chosen name and pronouns? What does it even mean to have a chosen name and pronouns? Also, how does this contribute to allyship and making spaces for trans people?
Great question. And number one, so what is a pronoun? You know, we all use pronouns when we are talking about people or if we're talking about ourselves in different ways. So we have, you know, in my little name thingy that you can see on the screen, he, him, I use he, him pronouns, and someone else may use she, her pronouns or they, them pronouns. And it's how we distinguish that we are talking about somebody. And these are really important to many of us that we, you know, people refer to us in the right way. You know, how many people get mad when somebody calls their male dog she or their female dog he, and people are so apologetic about it. So imagine if people were that serious about human pronouns. Now, why it's so important for you to use a trans person's pronouns, you're saying that you acknowledge that this person is the gender that they identify with. And it would be very insulting if somebody used the wrong pronouns for me after I've made it clear that I use he, him pronouns. And using new pronouns, it's a part of that transition process for so many people and part of that coming out. Names are very important, and a chosen name is a name that you have chosen for yourself. So I have the name that was given to me at birth by my parents, and that name didn't fit me. It wasn't a name that I felt comfortable with as I started my transition, and it's a name I no longer use. Many of us will refer to those former names as our dead names. And the name Vincent for me is very important because I chose it myself. It was a name that had a lot of meaning for me, and partially because of the things I was interested in at the time when I picked it. I really love vintage horror movies and Dutch impressionism. Van Gogh, favorite artist. And also it comes from the Latin word vincit, which means to conquer. So when you are a 16-year-old megalomaniac, it just makes sense. And why using somebody's name and pronoun makes a space safer? They know that they are accepted in that space when you're using their name and their pronoun. One of the most important things you can call a person is their name. It says that you are seeing them for who they are. Part of being an ally is not just using a person's name and pronouns. I mean, that is just human decency. Stepping it up by correcting people when they use the wrong name and pronoun for somebody else. So they're not always the one burdened with the work of correcting people who use their old name or use the wrong pronouns. And helping make policies in your workplace or in your community center or wherever you are involved that clearly specify why it's important to use a person's name and pronouns. These are all ways in which you can be allies and ways to make spaces safer for trans people.
Cool. You good? That's good. He's like, yeah, I'm done. Awesome. All right. So then we're going to open it up. So we want to know on the topic of pronouns or any maybe like questions back and forth, we're going to now open it up for a little mini discussion between our other two panelists. So first, I'm going to go to Tristan and then Rana. If you have any comments on pronouns, pronoun use, your own experiences with it, and or questions you want to ask Vincent, go ahead.
Vincent, thank you so much for sharing. I loved hearing how you picked your name. I think the nice thing about being trans or for anyone who picks their own name is that it gets to be special to you. And among the appropriate questions someone could ask someone who's trans is, I love your name. How did you pick it? Because that's something they got to choose about themselves. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Tristan. And thank you, Vincent, for sharing this. I was also very much curious to hear about your knowledge and experience and how you picked your name. That's a very interesting idea. Because for me, when it comes to pronouns, I'll be expanding a little bit more about my experience for sure in a bit, but I want to say it was definitely a very new language for me, three years and a half ago when I arrived to Canada, talking about pronouns, inclusive language, that was completely new for me, even though I'm part of the community, but where I came from, this language does not really exist, or I'm not very exposed to it. And then on also definitely lots of the communities underground, trying to survive. So I would say learning the language was something challenging for me, very interesting, very exciting. I was so curious. And I want to say the one thing I really loved about the community here, they were everyone knows that this is a new language. Everyone knows that we are practicing, we're trying, in general, people who are trying. So there was this space for, I feel that one of the learning or takes away for me is after 3 years, I do feel more comfortable to use this language. Do I make mistakes? Sometimes, yes, I do, but I try always to correct myself, carry on the conversation and continue. And I feel, I don't know if this is something you feel that, how you deal with people mistaking your gender or your name.
You can tell usually when somebody is making just a mistake, and mistakes happen. I've been working with trans people for many years. I have many trans friends and loved ones, and I sometimes slip up. I can tell when it's a slip up. Most of us can tell. And it's not the slip up that's what's hurtful. It's when people refuse to try and they refuse to use a person's name or pronouns. And when they brush it off, when you correct them and say, well, it's not important, it is really important. And so when you do mess up, the important thing to do is immediately correct yourself. You don't have to make it a big scene. In fact, making a big scene oh my God, I'm so sorry, that actually makes it worse. And what I do when somebody comes out to me and I have to get, and I want to get used to new names, new pronouns, and I don't want to make a mistake, I talk to my rabbit and I practice the person's name and pronouns with my rabbit. And because she can't talk, she's not going to tell somebody else and out this person. So I don't have to worry about confidentiality or anything like that. I practice, and it takes, 30 seconds in a day. I did this when Elliot Page came out because I had followed his career for so many years and I found myself slipping up. So for a week, or about 20 to 30 seconds a day, I was talking to my rabbit about Elliot Page. So if you did that with a friend who came out, imagine the difference you would make in that friend's life.
Yeah, I think when someone comes out and I need I get to use the new pronouns, I tend to, whenever I think of that friend, all in my head, say their pronouns in my head right after their name. That's helpful to connect their name and their pronouns like that. Then it becomes automatic.
I definitely created that space for myself in my house. As me and my partner, we speak also other languages, so it's very, very, very gendered. I can't stress how gendered the other language we speak. But yeah, we created that habit of when talking, because we both we're this is new for us. We wanna learn the language. We're coming from a background, we both work in human rights and all that. So we wanna be on top of our games, so yeah, I feel that at home we always we refer to other people using a plural pronouns, even when speaking other languages, even when there's no one around us and we can make all kind of mistakes or speak with a gender that feels easier for the language you have in your head. But yeah, I feel that definitely if I don't have a partner, I will definitely talk to a rabbit if I have a rabbit. I love to have a rabbit, by the way. Anyway.
That is awesome. Thank you so much, Vincent, for that discussion on pronouns and our other panelists for contributing. It's something that, so from an activist perspective, this is my job in our panel. So how do you then become an ally in terms of pronouns? Here's what you can do. Say your own pronouns, especially if you're unsure of the other person's. You say, me as a cisgender, meaning non-trans, often I introduce myself, hi, I'm Stephanie Voye. I use she, her pronouns. That tends to invite the other person to say their own. And even if they choose not to, you're creating a space where they are open to if they want to. So that's a good way to be an ally. All right. So we're going to now move on. Thank you. If you have any other questions about pronouns, please, please put them in the Q&A. We'd be happy to talk about them once we open it up in a while. We're going to now move on to Tristan's topic, which is on coming out. So Tristan, how can we support a friend who has come out, is coming out, and what is something helpful that someone has said or done for you when you've come out? Before, I want to preface this so that we understand coming out is kind of the metaphor of coming out of the closet, which is for queer people. If you're in the closet, it means you feel like you're hiding a piece of yourself. So that's just where it comes from. And so when you come out, it's kind of colloquial, but sometimes people don't understand why we say that. Tristan, you have to come out in different capacities all the time. Take it away.
I do. Yeah, like Steph was saying, coming out is the process of sharing an aspect of your identity for the first time. That could be for the first time with anyone, or that could be for the first time with one specific friend. So in the queer and trans context, this usually means disclosing your queer or trans identity. In other contexts, I'm sometimes white passing, but I'm half Asian. My mom is Filipino. So sometimes I've had to come out as Asian to someone who might not know that about me. It's always lovely to be able to come out in that context in a way that's positive, like, oh, you like Filipino food? Well, I'm Filipino, as opposed to a context where sometimes they might have to correct correct the other person, like, oh, I'm Filipino, and actually we don't use that word. Not Filipino, a different word. I'm so sorry. and like Vincent was saying, words matter. And I find that mirroring, if a friend were to come out to you, mirroring their words, mirroring their emotions are very important. So if someone comes out to you and they are excited to be coming out, throw a party. It is exciting. It is a good day for them. Some people might feel scared, and that's where you use your empathy and your compassion. If they're scared, then as a friend, you get to be there for them. Hold their hand, not physically right now, but metaphorically. My most positive experiences with coming out have always been where my friends, colleagues, or employers have listened and then immediately implemented my preferred language into their vocabulary. So they're mirroring my language. So that might be when I describe the person I live with using the word partner. That would also be using my pronouns and my preferred name. If someone comes out to you, I find the most helpful question you can immediately ask is, how can I support you? Sometimes when you come out, that moment might not be, or any moment might not be the appropriate time to ask questions about bodies or, methods. The best way is to have your friend tell you how they would like to be supported.
Right on. Yes. And when you're asking what Tristan's referring to, when you're saying like bodies and stuff, that's specifically for like trans. Well, I mean, actually, anyways, I mean, I'm queer, but don't ask about people's bodies. It's personal and private. You wouldn't ask straight people about that either. So same kind of thing, right?
That's- yeah, for sure. There's friends who you share medical information with. But if someone wants to share their medical information with you, they will share that information with you. Most people prefer not to be asked. Yeah.
Right. And it's especially sensitive with people who are transitioning because they're still figuring it out sometimes. Right. So on that, let's open up your coming out stories or experience having people come out to you. Vincent and Rana, go ahead.
I have a really funny coming out story. So in my case, I had to come out multiple times because first I came out as a lesbian, and then I came out as bisexual, and then pansexual. And then I, came out as trans. And when I came out to my parents, the response was mixed. First saying that I liked girls. And my dad didn't care so much. My mom didn't take it very well. Now, they came around. They didn't really care when I came out as a lesbian or when I came out later on as being pansexual. I was worried when I came out to them what they would think when I came out as trans. Again, they really struggled with that, and it took them a long time to accept that. Now they fully accept me. They come with me to Pride. They attend events that we put on. They'll probably watch this later. And then, given all of these experiences that I'd had with my parents, I always made assumptions on how my grandmother and grandfather, my Nona and Nono, would respond. And when I first came out as a lesbian, my Nona was totally okay with it. When I came out as trans, she was totally okay with it. It was not a problem. When I came out as vegan, it was the end of the freaking world. She didn't care who I was attracted to or how I identified, but if I stopped eating meat, that was it. And it took her a while to get over that, but she did. We had a very good relationship.
Oh, I never get enough from hearing coming out stories. It's where I came from. Coming out is not a thing, I would say, as I said, like being queer or trans or any identity outside of the binary model is not welcomed in where I came from. And I feel that like coming out would cost a person definitely being excluded from the society, like disowned by their family, or like definitely losing the support system. Like it's very similar in like there is some similarity to here, but I feel that there is still that in the extreme like people can also, it could sometimes like it could cost them their life as well. So I feel that I don't really have a fun coming out stories. I would say only one of my friends in the Middle East that I am aware that they are the only one who were accepted like gradually by their single mom, and because they're being raised by a single mom. So I feel that, and I always feel that, oh my God, I wish all moms in the Middle East, they would be like my friend's mom. I feel that there's still lots of work to do everywhere. Definitely, like that doesn't mean like I'm maybe bringing some kind of extreme stories of the spectrum of coming out, like especially coming from that side. And even here, when I say like we're here in Canada, yeah, things are different. We're in a much, much more progressive world, but yet I know from we know from a lot of our friends and the chosen family here, the difficulties, the challenges they face here as trans folks or people like racialized people. So yeah, so I just want to keep that. Like I know that it's much better here, but still there's a lot of work on all of us, like in awareness to raise in order for all of us to like support each other and create those spaces.
Right on. What a cool conversation. I think that there's going to be a lot of questions. I feel like coming out is such a personal thing, and it's every single time you do it, it's different, and you're never done coming out, right? So it's very dynamic there. And coming out, like Tristan said, can be a lot of things, whether it's, you know, your ethnicity, where you're from, your languages, all of that. So it's a very multifaceted kind of phrase. So again, if you have any questions for our, once we open it up for our Q&A and event, please write them down below. And with that, we are going to move it on to our friend Rana. So let's get to know you a bit better. Our main question for you that we want you to speak to is, how would you describe your experience as a relatively newcomer to the Canadian society or our system? what is new for you with challenges that you faced, and how are you navigating your way through? I'm going to add to this question too. You have said you're from the Middle East. What area are you from, and what is it like? So I'll open it up. Go ahead.
Thank you, Steph. So I'll try. I feel that I'm all over the place in my head. When I was like trying to prepare something to our talk today, because I feel that, should I share this? Do I feel safe enough to share this? So I will. I'll share as much as I can, and I'm happy to answer questions. I was raised in a relatively conservative society. I came from Syria, Aleppo, Aleppo city, and before coming to Canada, I was in Lebanon. And yeah, and if people doesn't know, like, yeah, there's it's a big mess happening in that area in terms of war and conflict and all of that. So I would say I was raised in this relatively conservative society with regards to gender and identities and sexuality. So in a place where people there's no freedom of expression, and the law serves a group of people, and it doesn't definitely aim for justice and equality for all. So I feel that anyone would like differ in any way that different from the norms, they definitely face a hard consequences. They definitely start to fear for their life, might be imprisoned or hold accountable for this, like being out of the norm. I arrived to Canada, as I said, like 3.5 years ago. I came with a high hopes, I'm coming to the country of diversity and equality, and a country where I would fulfill my dreams and live my true and authentic self. In the first year, I would say I learned a lot, and I got I got to know a very diverse queer community with many diverse gender identities, the language and all that, personalities. It was like mind blowing for me. And also like the different type of relationships and dynamics. And this is all I'm talking about within the community of LGBTQ2SAI+. As a newcomer, I brought with me my own knowledge, my academic background and degrees, and my work experience. So I feel that I arrived here with like a decent experience, and one of the challenges, I'm definitely, I know that I'm coming here to start over, but I didn't know that it will be that hard to get into to integrate well. Like, and I know that I'm someone like travels a lot, had friends from all over the world before coming to Canada, and I lived in Canada like a year back in 2012 in Montreal. So it's not that like the first time for me to come to Canada. So I was like, yeah, I mean, I have the experience, I have the knowledge, I'm educated, I speak the language, which is, I consider this is part of me being privileged coming to Canada, speaking the language already. I feel that one of the first challenges for me was, everyone was asking if I have the Canadian experience. And I was like, what does that mean? Because I came with international experience, because I worked before coming here, I was working with an international and local and international NGOs. And I felt like, yeah, what do you mean like Canadian experience? Maybe there's new tools, new work styles is different than Middle East, but yeah, that's about it. But everything else, we can get things going, we can get the work done. But I had this question about like, do you have the Canadian experience? And for me, like the one big question is like, what does that mean? And some people like break it down for me. It's like, yeah, you need to have like some kind of work here, like entry level work or something. And I'm like, in a place in my life, I arrived here with a, like I'm an, in a kind of, I would say advanced in my career, professional life already. So it was hard for me to feel that, oh, I have to go back because I need to have a Canadian experience. And one of the, like, lots of people told me, like, yeah, like, I can offer you, like, I can get you connection to have a work, like, a job at Starbucks or McDonald's or Mac. And, like, you can work for, like, a few months there and then you start to apply to other jobs. I'm like, that's insane. So I worked a couple of months or, like, a year in Starbucks, and then I got the Canadian experience, and then I jumped to work back to do the work I'm good at. So they were this kind of, I feel so, all the story just to say that Canada is like, for the world, is known as a, like, the diverse country, the acceptance and like society is like based on all this different people coming from different backgrounds and racial and ethnicity. So coming here, I felt like the system would be built based on like that perspective. Like when people are coming with new knowledge, the system will be like integrating this knowledge into that system rather than like the new knowledge trying to like find a way to fit in that society. Yeah, so I feel that was one of the main challenges that like I went definitely through like some confidence crisis and all of that, but things worked out. I feel that I was lucky enough, like through my work, my friends and network, they connect me to the job I'm leading now at Community as an education training specialist. I feel that the idea to say that I feel lucky or I was lucky, no one should accept it because I don't want to be lucky to get a job when I have all the experience and knowledge and the academic background. I want the system to be built in, like really open up, like having that, like not having like idea to accept people only who went through the system here. Like I was not born here or raised here or studied here. Like anyone else, so I don't have that privilege of other people. So how the system can, like how people can create, like in from their different positions, like create those spaces and opportunities for others. What else? I feel maybe I will stop a little bit here, maybe, or just talk. Also say a little bit more about the like. The opportunity, like when I got the job here at Community, and I was like, I became part of the conversations of that discussing the challenges members of 2S LGBTQAI plus and racialized people face in their workplaces. Talk about policies, procedures, how we can create safe spaces for all. The impact of the colonialism on systems and like enforcing the binary model, like in all the places. So I feel that I start to have like a different idea about how people perceiving, like think about like newcomers' experiences, like other underrepresented experiences, and how they can open up and create those spaces from their different roles. Okay, I think I will stop here. Okay, I can keep going on and on forever.
That's awesome. Thanks so much, Rana. There was just so much there, and I love listening because you have such a experience that, I mean, I've been to America and that's the only other country I've ever seen. And so I love when people who are worldly can share their stories. Thank you so much. Right on. So I'm going to open it up to Tristan and Vincent.
Yeah, Rana, as a newcomer, I have a parent who was at one time a newcomer, but everyone's experiences are different. She also landed in Montreal. What was something helpful that someone who's not a newcomer, so what was a way that someone who's not a newcomer has supported you, or what was helpful for that?
That's a very good question, Tristan, because I wanted also not only talk about issues, I want to propose some solutions or like something that was helpful, definitely. I'd say I was always grateful to all the people who were open to listen and learn and open up to other ways of being. Like, for instance, I always, like, at work, me and my supervisor, we get along very well from the, like, career and professional perspectives, and how we, like, the philosophy, how we want to, like, raise awareness in the society. I feel that if, when he hired me, if he only wants to look at my background and say, like, hey, Rani, you don't have the experience talking about LGBTQ plus here because you never lived here, you don't know the history, and you don't have the language. And that's very true, because I did not have that language. But what I brought with me is, like, all the experience, like, on training and working with people from different political affiliation and different aspects. And I was facilitating a lot of hard conversations before coming here for the past, like, over 8 years at least. And then so I feel that if he wants just to focus on what I need to bring to this role in just a, like, very limited perspective, I wouldn't get that job as well. But he was like, okay, Rana maybe doesn't know the language, but it's okay. We'll give her, like there's time for her to learn the language. It's not a big deal to learn the language, but that experience you bring with you, that's what we need. That skill of, like, holding space for people who have very different point of view, creating safe spaces for people to express themselves and, like, finding solutions together and moving forward and creating a change. That's what I'm kind of good at. So yeah, I feel that, like, being open to other, like, being open, being curious, and, like, yeah, there's no one way, one right way to do things. Does that make sense? So that's something I appreciated in, like, with that, with my experience at work and with other people in my personal life as well.
Cool. All right, Vincent, you have anything?
I think that, you know, in my experience, so three of my grandparents were immigrants, and most of my family around me, I grew up around an immigrant family, and, you know, acknowledging that we're all settlers here unless you are Indigenous, and that everyone's family, or almost everyone's family, has that history. And, you know, I heard stories from my Nono and Nona when they were still alive about how much of a difference it made that they had people around them that supported them. And so part of the allyship, it's not just being an ally to somebody because of their gender identity or their sexual orientation, but allyship for all parts of who a person is.
That's great. All right. So that concludes our first part of our panel discussion. Thank you so much. So right now, I'm not sure if, I think I just, do I give it over to Sylvia again? I think I do. Maybe not. All right. Well, that's okay. We are going to go over to our second performer. Oh, Sylvia, go ahead.
Hi. Actually, we are going to go on to the QA. But before that, we are going to have our performer. We are going to have Asaya performing the song Horizon.
Hello, everyone. Happy to be back. All right. So this song that I will be singing is a song that I have recently written. It's called Horizon. And basically, it's about just going through the hard times, but making sure you're still holding on to the light at the end of the tunnel. And yeah, no matter how hard it gets, there's always beauty in the ending and through the journey. So yeah. I just gotta patient. Yeah, I'm just gonna roll up before we bow to the lake. Oh, I've been to tip my drink up. I'm living in the second, cause every day's a blessing. Mistakes disguise as lessons. This life be really testing me. So I'ma make my own ways. I move as smooth as weight. My God in heaven made. It's never catching shade. Been to live in the moment before that shit gets stolen. My cards are being played. And I ain't trying to fall down. It's a long, dark road, but my light shines. I rise, I grind. You can't break my flow. My garden grows on the path I chose. So I gotta trust the process and work a little harder. I'm gonna be so much smarter. It'll get me so much farther. Be living in the present, cause every day's a gift. I'm not trying to go stress it. No, I'm never gonna quit. And I can't stop, and I won't stop, and I can't ever let my hope drop. Keep my head high, I'ma get by, I'ma get mine up on cloud nine. Try to trust that I was born for this. I'ma be good with the way that I live. Gotta get back up again. Not about it when it's all about when. And it's a long, dark road, but my light shines. I rise, I grind. Can't break. It's a long, dark, dark road. My light shines, I rise, I grind. You can't break my flow. My garden grows on the path I chose.
That was great. And now I'm gonna pass it. Thank you so much. Thank you for your talent. I'm gonna pass it to Steph. Steph, please, if you could now introduce a section of the Q&A to see if anyone is there with questions. Thank you.
Yes, wonderful. Oh my gosh, how talented. Thank you so much. What a beautiful performance. I am in awe. Very entertaining. Thank you so much. And I'm using my words because it's not like, you know, I'm imagining like roaring applause through the screen on the other side of all of this live stream. All right, so let's move on to our FAQs. If you have questions that you're too shy to ask through the chat, because yes, everyone will see it, feel free to DM us on Instagram. Mallory is also monitoring our Instagram, which is at rainbowcamp.ca. If you're not following, shameless plug, go ahead and follow our Instagram. Also, if you're not subscribed to the channel you're streaming this on, please do that. We are trying to grow our YouTube this Pride, and this summer we're doing a lot of more events like this. So a lot more education, fun stuff, kids-based programming, and also just parent support as well. So please go ahead and subscribe if you are not already, so you don't miss any of the cool events we have coming up. All right, enough vamping, Stephanie. We have some questions coming in. So we have a few, and I'm sure there'll be more rolling in. Again, if you're too shy to ask them publicly, you can just DM us on Instagram. Again, that's at rainbowcamp.ca. And that is okay. So our first one is about pronouns. I'm assuming Vincent will probably want to start this one off, but if the other panelists want to chime in, you can just turn off your mics after Vincent's done talking, and then just jump in. Okay. So this question is, do you have any advice for young teens who are feeling unsure of what pronouns fit them?
Yes. Try them all. Try whichever ones you feel like trying. You don't have to pick a pronoun and then carve it in stone, tattoo it on your forehead and say, I'm using this for the rest of my life. And guess what? The same is true for names. It is okay to explore and try things out. It was a year before I came up with the name Vincent. And it was a year of my girlfriend saying, are you sure you want to use that name for the rest of your life? And her and I trying out different names. So sometimes it is a matter of trying out what works for you. And I know young people and even some older people who try a name for a few weeks, try out pronouns, go, you know what? Now that I've heard it out loud and saw it on paper, it doesn't seem to fit. And then we'll use another one. And part of being that supportive person is trying out these names and pronouns with the person and just going with it until they find the right one.
Any other thoughts, Tristan, Rana? No? Cool. Right on. That's good stuff. Thank you so much. This next one I think is more directed at you, Tristan. It's a question on, but anybody I'm sure has thoughts on it as well. Were all your friends supportive and understanding? When you came out, did you have to seek out a different community or different friends? Tristan?
That's a really good question. Thank you so much for asking. As someone who always presented a little more masculinely, most of my friends were already queer friendly and already aware that perhaps at least non-binary. All of my friends were very positive, and the friends that I've kept closer after coming out, because I only came out like 3 years ago, the friends that I kept closest or closer were the ones who had the best reactions to me coming out. I do have some friends who I haven't formally come out to, though it's very obvious on social media that I use a different name and different pronouns now. Some of my friends perhaps aren't explicitly queer friendly. For me, just waiting, if they want to let me know that they're an ally, then they're going to come to me and let me know they're an ally. I have lots of friends who are supportive, so I don't need friends who aren't excited about me being trans. Is that a helpful answer?
Mm-hmm. But I'm going to add, as one of Tristan's friends from before and during and after you came out, in terms of like your community more expanded rather than people didn't necessarily leave. I think it was more like, I was like, oh, and I have this friend, meet Vincent, meet this person. And so I think that like when you have the right kind of people in your space, the right kind of people are going to help you find more of the right kind of people, if that makes sense. Yeah, I think Vince is frozen. Oh no, that's okay. At least you're smiling a little. All right. next question, which is a bit of a heavier. Sorry. Go ahead.
My internet died. What part did you hear?
You finished speaking and it was eloquent and lovely. I just was talking about you, and that's okay. All right. Cool. So this next question is a little heavier, but and kind of more intense. Before we do, let's open up that coming out question. What about Rana, Vincent? You both have different perspectives on this. What do you guys think, if anything?
I would say I have my experience even before learning more about my exploring more and knowing where I'm at in the spectrum and who I am and gender and my gender and sexuality. I feel that I know that a lot of people in my life before coming here, they would come to me to talk about their sexuality, and I feel that one takeaway for me when it comes to coming out, when I tell people if someone comes to you, chooses you to talk about this very personal thing with you, really, first of all, I feel very honored to be that person. Second thing, if you don't know how to be supportive, and if you don't know how to support, you simply ask questions, ask that person, how can I best support you? And I at the time, I didn't know much. And my only tool I had is ask question and check with that person, what can I do? Maybe they just want to talk and they just want me to listen. They don't want anything else from me. Or maybe they feel that this is a safe space for them and they want to be themselves around me. And that's I need to create that space more often for them. So yeah, I feel that if you don't know, just ask questions. How you might support them better. Thank you.
I lost a lot of friends when I first came out. I've lost some family members, and it was a mixed experience for me when I came out. And when I first came out as trans, it was 2004 in Sudbury when no one was talking about this. So it was a mixed bag. With a lot of people I came out to when I came out as trans, I had to also tell them what transgender meant when I told them, because there wasn't as much awareness then as there is now. But what I have found over the years, as there's become more awareness here and more understanding, it has gotten easier in the sense that I don't have to explain what it is. People have had that time to hear about it from somewhere else before they hear about it from me. So it's not as awkward as it used to be, because they go, I've never heard of this. Are you sure this is a real thing? You know, that was something I experienced a lot of when I first came out. But now that I'm not that person's first experience of ever knowing what the word transgender is, that's made it a lot easier. And there are people in pop culture that they can make that reference to. So they go, oh, you know, you're trans, like Elliot Page. I just adore him. I'm going to just name drop him as much as I can in these things. So it's definitely a different experience talking about this in 2021 than it has been in the beginning of this century.
Yes, those are all really, really good points. And this is we could have a whole other panel just on coming out issues and stuff, because it's so different for everybody. And oh my goodness, it's one of my favorite stories. When people, we're storytellers, I think, by nature, humans are, and that's good fuel for conversation, that's for sure. Okay, so I'm going to ask some of these questions a little out of order, and simply because I think this next question is almost like a follow-up for what we were just talking about. So for all of you, I suppose, was the community supportive of your decision, or were there people that lashed out? And I guess maybe that's more family community. I'm not sure what the specific community is, or like what people means in this case, but I'll leave it to you folks to consider what story you feel like you want to share on that. Anybody want to start?
I can start. I think right away when I came out and then I went to Rainbow Camp. I know not everyone gets to go to Rainbow Camp, so that was really lucky for me. So that was a really fantastic experience to just, yes, yeah, Vincent, just be surrounded by a bunch of other people who are like unashamedly queer. I have been on the other end. I was also raised in an extremely problematic and conservative church community. So as a young teen, I have been on the other end where when a friend came out to me, I did, you know, make it all about me, like perhaps ask some questions that weren't appropriate. And I'm now that I'm older, I'm able to seek forgiveness for that, but also forgive myself for not being a fantastic friend.
I had different experiences from the community at large when I was still identifying as a lesbian. I was still attending a Catholic church and I was attending a Catholic all-girls school. And when I came out at school, my teachers and the principal made my life a living hell. So it was not a good experience. Around the time I came out at church, this was when, just before same-sex marriage was legal in Ontario, they were passing around a petition at this church that I went to help prevent that legislation from passing. And I found that the faith community I had once belonged to was not an affirming place for me, nor was that school. But when I switched to the public school system, it was a completely different experience, completely different. And there are, of course, Catholics who are very supportive and other faith communities that are very supportive. But I found community at large, it really depended on the place and the time. You know, I rarely have people yell slurs at me from their pickup trucks when I'm walking down the street in Sudbury, but I get called a slur at least once every time I go to Toronto. So it's interesting because you'd expect that more in Northern Ontario, but I find here it's more ignorance than hostility, where people will ask inappropriate questions because they just don't know. Whereas, you know, here in Sudbury, you don't see people protesting pride, but you go to Toronto and people do. There, it's not ignorance, it's hostility. And it's been a very interesting journey to realize that.
To what Vincent is saying, I feel that it's just a constant reminder for all of us, like, because we always think like, hey, yeah, we have the like laws in place to protect us all as human rights and gender diversity and all the backgrounds we came from, but yet the lived experience is not that at all. And as you said, like Vincent is like, we're like, there's a big gap between the law and the lived experience and all this ignorance that exists in the community and in a cities like Toronto, where we think like, or I didn't visit Toronto yet, but all things I hear about Toronto, like how it's very advanced city, like very progressive and all of that, but yet like people really doesn't know how, like the basic human decency interaction with other folks. So yeah, I feel that it's a reminder for us to also think why why in the first place some group of people, they have to come out every day, and other people, they just like take it for granted that they are accepted and they know that they will be treated with dignity and with respect. What does that, like, ask yourself these questions, understand the privileges you came from, and like try to navigate the world like having these questions and like that, those check-ins every day. That might be helpful for all of us.
Absolutely. And that's where, I mean, I grew up in Canada and I came from a, you know, supportive family, raised in a small town that was relatively safe, right? Like for me coming out wasn't, I knew everything was going to be fine. It wasn't like a political act. Whereas in other places and spaces and religions, even like all of these different factors can weigh in on safety and stuff. So in a way, coming out, so when people lash out, it's not always like a personal thing. It can, depending on the place and space you're in, it can be considered just a response to a political act almost, and not so much against an individual, which I think is an interesting thing that we can think about, especially as Canadians in our space. Yeah. Anyway, I just want to trouble that notion a little bit because I know some of my students are watching. Okay, so the specific question for Vincent, and then I have one for, I think, Rana after. I have a question for Vincent. Why, you don't have to answer this, but why, I'm literally reading it, Vincent. You don't have to answer this, but why did you decide to change your name? How did your parents feel about this decision to change your name? And they named you, so good question. Go ahead.
It was a very interesting argument with my parents when I first handed them the change of name forms, because I was 17, so I needed their signature. Oh, sorry, I was 16, almost 17. And I said, Mom and Dad, I need you to sign these. And they were very upset. Part of it was they didn't know a lot about this whole journey I was going on, and they were very afraid of what would happen to me. And they put a lot of thought into the name they gave me. Funny enough, no one, like when I was a kid, my parents mostly called me by a nickname, not my actual name. It was only when I was in really big trouble that my mom actually called me by that given name. That's when I knew, run. or come up with a lie on the spot. But it was something that meant a lot to them. But for me, it was just really painful to hear, because it was that constant reminder that the world didn't see me as who I really am. And it was a bit of a process for them. So they actually signed the forms for me to change my name before they started calling me Vincent. And the reason that came about was I had started working in my first part-time job. And when I came out at work, it did not go over well. It was a pretty awful experience when I had asked them to put Vincent on my name tag and they outright refused to do it. And I said to my parents, I said, look, I'm starting my first job. I don't have a credit card yet. I don't have a credit history. I'm still in high school. Now is the best time for me to change my name, because if I wait any longer, if I wait until I turn 18 and get my first credit card and have more jobs and all that, it is just going to make this harder. I need to do it now. So I appealed to that part of it. And that's what got them to agree to sign the forms initially, knowing that just logically, it would have been a lot harder to do it later. And it was still a few months though before they started calling me Vincent. So it was a journey. But you know, I changed my name legally 14 years ago. And for me, that other name is a distant memory now.
Awesome, thanks. So I have two more questions, and so we want to ensure that we have some time. We only have a little bit of time left, but so let's keep it brief, but they're important questions, and so I really want to make sure we get to them. This one's, I think, more directed towards Rana, because it's about newcomers. I lost it. There it is. Question on newcomers. Could you speak about how allies can help break the barriers, especially when there is the intersection of gender identity and social prejudices, such as against Islam or dark-skinned people?
Thank you very much. That's a very good question. And I want to say that, like, everything I'm sharing is coming from my personal experience, obviously, and it's definitely, I cannot really represent everyone's experience in this country when it comes, because I know that I pass in so many places, like I pass and no one would, like, before I open up my mouth and start speaking, people realize that, oh, English obviously is not your language. So before that, I know that I pass and things are like easier for me. Like when I go with my partner who has like a darker skin, and I would say, like, yeah, I would see that, like, the difference there. So I feel that I acted as an ally to my partner in certain situations, just because I see like mistreatment or like, yeah, based on that, like, obviously, yeah, the look. And that's something like very much shocking for me. It's very, like, I feel that the role of allies is like, I can't stress how huge it is in the community and also in any like human rights issues. When you're aware of your privileges, it's easier for you to be that person to speak up and explain. It's like, rather than that person like being in that very vulnerable situation, to come forward and like try to explain what they're going through and how things could be better for them. So this, the role of the like allies, like, I feel big part of like me, like, also learning a lot about the trans folks and friends, like, challenges they deal with in their day-to-day life, and for a very simple interaction. Like, we always talk about washrooms and the challenges and the anxiety that comes with just using washroom, like, simple thing we all do in every day. But for me, like, learning all these details, like, I feel that, yeah, part of my, like, motivates me every day when I hold those spaces in my workshops and talk about it. Like, I have a different energy when I talk about it. I feel like it's not only my work, I feel that even in my personal life, like, I always like keep myself updated and I feel, and educating myself. And that's what I really invite everyone to really first and understand your privileges, your biases. You're holding lots of different roles companies, organizations. You are decision makers, you're leaders, and you're someone can make, and even if you're not in a very high position, I always say, like, individual efforts is very, make a big difference from the minute you are, like, anyone accessing service and you're the one who's saying hi to them. From the minute you start to introduce yourself with your pronouns and like creating that space, it's very, like, sometimes it's simple practices that helps others to feel safe and be themselves. So I'd say, like, really, be curious, be an ally, be consistent with the work, with your work of creating safe spaces for all. Be the voice for those who are underrepresented, and most importantly, like, continue to educate yourself and people around you. I will stop here. I know the time is very.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Rana. I love that. And talking about allyship, and to us at Rainbow Camp too, what we always say to everybody, allyship is not enough to just not, you know, oh yeah, I'm okay with queer people, I'm okay with people of color. That's not enough. That's not really an ally. That's just being tolerant. What means being an ally is using spaces of privilege to create space in a world where not everybody has equitable rights. And so me as a white person, I create space to hear voices that don't get heard accurately or as often as white voices do. So being an ally is using your privilege in a way that helps others. It's not just being passive and, you know, being okay with things. It's actively taking your space or allowing your space to be shared with others. All right, last question. So answer it kind of briefly, but this is for all of you, and I think it's a good one. So you've all beautifully described responsibilities that non-LGBTQ people or folks should exercise in an effort to enhance inclusivity. Let's expand this and this discussion, and what can and should members do in the community to enhance acceptance and inclusivity? So this is, again, just building on that allyship, which is why I like it for last. So just maybe in like one or two sentences on your given topic. Rana, you already talked a little bit about this, but if you have any other ideas, Tristan on coming out maybe, or whatever our thoughts, Vincent, pronouns, et cetera, go.
I
either one of you. Sorry.
Educate yourself and watch videos and read articles by community members and stand up for people, even when people are not around, and correct people when they say things that are transphobic, homophobic, racist, xenophobic. Speak up.
Yeah, I think on that line, like if someone says that's something you did might have come off as transphobic, homophobic, xenophobic, apologize and re-educate yourself. That's a moment to, instead of doubling down on your beliefs, to check yourself. I think also looking around at the unconscious biases we have, and then addressing those. So if your workplace has a men and women's single bathroom, addressing like how that doesn't, like instead of making the trans person address that, you could address it. Or even like the men's bathroom doesn't have a garbage, like you can address that issue, those kinds of things.
I would add like also like how you should be courageous to take stand and speak out. I just wanted to bring a very quick example of a friend of mine who is Black, a woman, veiled, like wears hijab, who faced a very discriminative act last year in her company, where like a client decided not to see her and say, like, we're introducing everyone in the team and like skipped her. And her manager basically did not do anything at the time. And she only said like, oh, and there's this person, she introduced my friend. When I heard that story, I was like, I don't understand the manager position, like that manager who is a woman as well. She was white, the manager. So you're in a powerful position. You saw that action happening. How come you did not step up and say something to that client? Are you afraid to lose the client? Or like, yeah, it's okay, like to ethically, break all the ethical values of your company, because all companies, like they have all their values and like slogans like flying around. So I just wanna say like, please be courageous in any position you're at. And if you don't feel that you can speak up and stand out for other people and create that space for everyone, please step down, because I don't think it's like, we're living in a world where we need like courageous people to take to create those spaces. So yeah, thank you.
Awesome. On that note, I think that was a really great conversation. I guess we're going to go a little over time, but thank you so much to our panelists. I didn't want to cut you off. You're all so smart and had wonderful, eloquent, you know, stories to share, and I really think that it was valuable. And I know there were probably other questions that we didn't get to. Mallory just sent me some of them, so thank you so much again for Mallory to send me all these things. Thank you for people who ask questions, and also ask questions. It's not the responsibility of any LGBT person or BIPOC individual to, you know, educate necessarily, so you should work to educate yourself in terms of allyship. But if you're not sure if somebody's like a boy or a girl or what, you know, that kind of thing, the appropriate way to ask is like, hey, how do you identify? Or what are your pronouns? Asking is always better than assuming and embarrassing someone. So, you know, living allyship rather than performing allyship is very important. Not just doing it to, you know, get, oh, it's Pride Month, check mark, I did it. No, like, live it, believe it. And that's hopefully you've got some tips on how to do that today. Just a reminder that we are collecting donations, so Mallory will share the link if you want to donate. Also, please subscribe, follow, all of the things that you can find links to down below, I'm sure. And with that, I'm going to introduce another guest we have. Carmela is a drag queen and is going to close us out with a recorded performance. But before that, we are going to hear a little bit about what drag means to them. Go ahead. Thank you very much for being here.
Hi, thank you for having me. I just wanted to start off before I get into my spiel that I am currently streaming on the unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, in particular the Musqueam, Squamish, Stolo, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations. They're also, it's the same area where I made my video as well. But I was someone that grew up with an interest in the arts, and drag is something that gave me the opportunity to speak my truth creatively. And my drag focuses on empowering Black women and their voices and experiences. And as social justice becomes a bigger part of our everyday lives, I have also used my drag platform as a means to propel social justice movements by choosing songs that have a strong message to them. And today you'll be seeing a video made to highlight and celebrate the Black experience, and hopefully it will bring some Black joy to your screens. Should you want to reach out, you can do so by following me on Instagram, which is at Carmela Barr, K-A-R-M-E-L-L-A-B-A-R-R, all smushed together. Or you can follow me on Facebook. On my Instagram, there's a link in my profile that gives an opportunity to support an Indigenous and Black charity should you be financially able to. There's also many other opportunities as well. I have a social justice tab, like a story tab. And of course, I included Rainbow Camp in there, because it's an amazing association and I strongly believe in what they're doing. So please feel free to check that out and sort of use that to help propel your allyship moving forward. I hope that you enjoy the performance, and thank you so much for having me.
Does it look like it's not working, Mallory? Oh, one second. If it doesn't work, then again, we'll just make a separate video and then we'll add, like, we'll embed a link to it. I hope it does though. So Mallory, we'll just wait one second. Thank you so much for being patient, everybody. I don't know, should I perform?
Yes.
All right, here we go.
Ain't got no home, ain't got no shoes, ain't got no money, ain't got no class, ain't got no skirts, ain't got no sweater, ain't got no perfume, ain't got no bed, ain't got no mind. Ain't got no mother, ain't got no culture, ain't got no friends, ain't got no schooling. Ain't got no love, ain't got no name, ain't got no ticket, ain't got no token, ain't got no God. And what about God? Why am I alive anyway? Yeah, what about God? Nobody can take away. Got my hair, got my head, got my brains, got my ears, got my eyes, got my nose, got my mouth, I got my smile. I got my tongue, got my chin, got my neck, got my boots, got my heart, got my soul, got my back, I got my sex. I got my arms, got my hands, got my fingers, got my legs, got my feet, got my toes, got my liver, got my blood, I've got life. I got my freedom, I've got life. I've got life, and I'm gonna keep it. I've got life, and nobody's gonna take it away. I've got life.
Should be good.
That's groovy.
Okay, so thank you so much, Carmela, for that performance. We all love Nina Simone, and I hope a lot of you know about her and her activism. She was a great singer and activist in the 60s. A lot of people followed her, and a lot of people like her, and I still like her, and I listen to her a lot. So, and this is the end of our event. But before we leave, I just wanted to say a few things, especially when it comes to allyship and when it comes to power. Can you see me? Because I don't see myself in the camera. Okay, thank you. So, allyship. I just want to make clear that not only white people are allies, and not only white people have the power to be allies. We all have a power. We all have the time. We all have the conscience. We all have the love, and we all have the caring to be an ally, not only the white people. And so use that little power that you may have to help the other and to be understanding of the other. So that is number one that I wanted to say. And then I just wanted to thank everybody for being here today. I wanted to thank the panelists. Thank you so much for sharing your stories that sometimes can be very hard to do. So I thank you all very much. You have been very brave to share your stories with us, with people that you don't know. So thank you so much. And we learned so much today from you. Thank you. I also want to thank the artist. Thank you. Thank you, Asaya, for your grace, for your music, for your voice. Thank you so much. And I want to thank Carmela as well. Thank you so much for your drag performance. We enjoyed it very much. And thank you for the song that you picked. That's a very iconic song. And so that's it. And I want to thank you, all of you. All of you that have taken the time to be here with us and to share with us and to listen to our guests, because that was the key for this event today, to give a platform for our guests to express themselves and for our guests to be listened. And so I want to thank you all. Thank you very much for being here today. And so I'm pleased, even though this program was free, but it's still, you know, all these performers, and to put all this event together, it takes a little bit of resources. So we are asking you to please, please, please donate for this beautiful cause. And so thank you very much, and goodbye.